The Golden Age, the dream of a land of perfection that has haunted men since the beginnings of civilization, took on a special poignancy and urgency in the Romantic Age. For the 19th century in Europe was also the age of rapid industrialization, of steam and soot and machines that threatened to replace liberty with progress. In England, France, and Germany, artists tried to return to an age that was less complicated, less compromised, less cluttered than their own. The models for this ideal world were various, but all were long past. The classical world of Greece and Rome, the fantasy medieval world of chivalry and troubadours, the world of folklore and legend. But the most potent model of perfect innocence and clarity was a world lodged deep in all of us, the world of childhood.
His parents were already in bed and asleep. The clock ticked its monotonous rhythm. The young man lay uneasily on his couch. "It's not material treasures which have awakened such a powerful longing in me," he said to himself. "I'm far removed from any avarice, but I long to look on the blue flower. It fills my senses ceaselessly, and I can think and breathe nothing else. I have never felt like this before. It's like a dream. As if I had dozed off into another world. For who cares about flowers in the world that I inhabit? I've never before heard of such singular passion for a flower. I would have believed I was going mad, but I saw and thought things with such amazing lucidity. Since then, I have felt that I can understand things more easily. I once heard talk of times gone past, how animals and trees and rocks communicated with man. It now seems to me that they could start speaking at any moment, and I know what it is they want to say to me. But there must be many words I do not know. If I only knew more, I would be able to comprehend still more easily. Once I loved dancing. Now I would rather think of the music." The boy gradually lost himself in sweet fantasies and fell asleep. He dreamed of far-off, wild, and undiscovered regions. He seemed to wander over the sea with inexplicable ease. All emotions rose within him to an unprecedented peak. He lived a wonderfully colorful life. He died and came back to life. He loved with the deepest passion and was then separated forever from his loved ones. Finally, towards morning, as dawn broke, his soul became calm, and the images more clear and more enduring.
Thus begins the novel which Novalis never completed, called Heinrich von Ofterdingen. In it, Novalis depicts the life of a young dreamer and his intangible yearning. The blue flower for which he longs becomes a symbol of romanticism. It is a longing for those things which lie on the other side of the boundaries of everyday life. To the question, "Where are we going?" Ofterdingen replies, "Always home." In this age of upheaval, there emerged a feeling of longing for the realm of peace, a dream of a golden age, which it was felt must have existed before and would surely come again. A new morning, a golden childhood.
Childhood tranquility, heavenly calm. How often I stand dumb before you in loving contemplation and wish to think back to you. But it seems we can only conceive of what was once bad and then was made good again. We have no conception of childlike innocence. When I was a silent child and knew nothing of the facts of our lives, I still knew no less than now. Despite all the heartache, the pondering, and the struggling, the child is whole within himself, and is thus beautiful. The power of laws and destiny do not burden him. He personifies freedom. He knows peace. He has not destroyed it himself. He has riches. He holds it in his heart and knows not the shabbiness of life. He is immortal because he knows nothing of death.
The German writer Hölderlin foundered, like so many romantics, because he had driven himself too far in his search for a lost paradise. He spent the last decades of his life alone in his attic room in Tübingen. There was talk that he was mentally deranged. In the piece that he found there, he wrote,
"Beauty is for children alone. It is perhaps the image of God himself. Tranquility is theirs, and still the angel stretches out to praise."
Robert Schumann's graceful miniatures for piano, Kinderszenen, scenes of childhood, reveal nothing of the misery and mental illness which he encountered at the end of his life.
That is the way to true life. Stay a child, for only a child is capable of the most profound love.
So wrote Philipp Otto Runge, painter of the most intense images of children of the Romantic period.
We cannot retrieve unity within ourselves until we return to the primary warmth and intimacy of feeling. Until we are transformed back into children.
The vision of a human utopia is set against a background of great turmoil and industrial upheaval. The machine age was dawning. Runge wrote in a letter,
"We live in a confused, sad, terrible age. He who keeps beauty and good lovingly within his heart will always reach his goal. We must try to be like children again if we want to achieve the best."
At only 33 years of age, Runge dies of consumption. His next project was to be the illustration of a new series of children's tales.